Hey, Boss listeners, this is Nick, and you're listening to another episode of the Books of Some Substance podcast. I had the chance to chat with Alex Edkins of the Toronto punk band METZ on the day that their latest record, Atlas Vending, came out. Alex highlighted J.G. Ballard's High-Rise as a favorite, so we talked through the psychological inner space prophecies of the book and relate it back to our current technology-saturated landscape. Spoiler alert, we are all animals, and the internet isn't exactly helping. But before getting into the conversation, here's a clip of METZ performing their new song, Blind Youth Industrial Park. Since we're chatting today on release day for Atlas Vending, I just want to acknowledge that I'm totally in love with this record. I mean, I think it's my favorite METZ record, but specifically from a personal standpoint, you know, I think like the wear and tear of not being able to go to shows and all that for 6, 7, 8 months, whatever we're on, is like starting to get to me. So that actual like feeling of like musical catharsis and that has been like really important to me, I'm realizing. So I just want to say thank you for that. That's been great listening to this record.
Oh, wow. Thank you. I mean, yeah, I agree. It's something that I'm missing, you know, heavily. You know, I feel like that part of my life has been put on pause or taken away. And it's you really start to notice how much you're kind of leaning on it at times or depending on it to be there for you mm-hmm. and to bring you so much. So, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I found myself leaning even further into records and books and films and stuff. And I think that's been kind of my way to get through. And so I guess just to start, since this is a podcast about books and pulling influences from them, you know, what's your life as a reader? What did you get into originally? What are you reading now? Just all that good stuff.
You know, I don't know when I first really fell in love with reading, but it might have been like during the band, like, you know, being in the van, in the back of the van and reading all the time. But I mean, I tend to go one of two ways. I go either, you know, musical biography or autobiography, which I mm-hmm. just, you know, devour endlessly. Doesn't matter who it is. I find it fascinating. And then on the other side, sort of dark fiction, where it's kind of asking some of the big questions, some of the existential questions within, you know, a human story. So yeah, one extreme to the other.
How much would you say, both in songwriting, so for lyrics or musical aesthetics, how much would you say that you pull from that? Is it connected directly in like a concept style, or is it maybe just sort of absorbed a little bit more indirectly?
I think it's indirect. One thing I do, I find myself doing when it's, you know, time to write a new record, is I love to just kind of peruse bookshops, and I just kind of stare at the spines, and I think that sets off a lot of words and ideas that can sometimes be jump off points. And then, of course, mm-hmm. you know, nothing like a good story to spark lyrical ideas as well. But I think it's indirect. I think it's something that subconsciously kind of finds its way into our songs.
Yeah, I was thinking about that, you know, as we were getting ready to talk, just the arc of METZ Records. And the newest one, I think the thing that I'm so hooked on is that there's almost this sort of hypnotic tension that's built into some of those songs, specifically the first song and the last song. I'm like totally addicted to those two songs. And I'm wondering, you know, how much of that comes from like, again, like a thoughtful progression of, hey, moving beyond, you know, some of like the, just the purely anthemic stuff into, you know, trying to explore, I don't know, landscapes and thoughtscapes that to me feel more like you know, directly tied to dark fiction and those kinds of concepts.
Right. I mean, I think it has just been really an evolution over time, and we're just finding ourselves in a different headspace musically. And also, I think, with a sort of a new confidence to go to places maybe we were unsure of before. I think there's a certain, that's definitely playing into this new record and allowing us to kind of spread our wings a little bit, if you will, like just not shy away from having a range of, you know, musical, you know, ideas and a range of musical moods on a record. So it's actually something that I think we're going for, attempting to have within our albums now, whereas I think when we got our start, it was kind of one mindset. It was very much an aggressive, short and quick kind of gut punch mindset, and now that's just changing as we change as people, I think.
So how do your lyrical approaches and mindsets change if you're sort of transitioning from that kind of earlier gut punch stuff into things that are a little bit more expansive?
I've always written from, you know, a pretty personal place. But yeah, it obviously, the lyrical content is definitely affected by the sound of the music. It's the last kind of part of the puzzle for me. So there's no doubt that it is having an impact on kind of where my mind goes when I'm trying to put, you know, pen to paper. So, but again, I don't really have much control of it. Sometimes I'm, you know, surprised of what comes out, and it's sort of, I try to let that happen and not self-edit too much. Because I think, although I don't always understand it is, you know, I think you have to let it flow, let it come out, and then it usually makes more sense to me down the line somehow. That being said, it is not like this easy thing. I do find it a struggle. I'm not a natural writer in that way, where some people just, I think they just turn the tap on and it comes out of them, you know. But for me, it is a struggle, and it's something I work at, and it's something that, like I said before, very much impacted by the sound of the music, that we like the song that we've written musically. So I let that kind of lead the way.
Can you talk a little bit about, so the clip at the beginning that we listened to, Blind Youth Industrial Park, there's a new video for that that to me feels very J.G. Ballard, right? And so how did that come about? Is there a direct tie into that, or am I just connecting lines due to the fact that we're here to talk about High Rise?
Yeah, that video I just absolutely love, and I think of it as almost a mini sci-fi film. And you know, but then again, we just got lucky. We pick the directors we want to work with, but you know, it just so happens we've had so many times where they just continuously blow our minds and bring us something far exceeding what we expected, and that's one example of just being like, wow, you know, fully, we can take no credit in that domain. It's very much the directors who we let off, like we just let them go for it, and we've been lucky that they just happen to bring back something that really elevates our music. I think, you know, that song, more or less being pretty simple song about looking back and about sort of realizing that you're not capable of going back and changing the things you've done. Sort of, you know, it's a song about reveling in, well, not, it's about kind of realizing how special your time as a youth is, and how it's like that there's a beauty in that naivety, but also realizing that as you grow older, it's like, you know, there's no turning back. You have to move forward. So, I can't tell you how that was tied to a mini sci-fi film video, but I love some of the connections that it must create for the viewer and the listener.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a perfect intro into talking about dark fiction and Ballard specifically. It's just that, you know, those dark narratives, and like you say, I think there's an important thing in art, whether it's music or books, that allows room for the listener or the reader to kind of attach themselves to it, right?
Absolutely.
And so that's definitely what I get from that, is just that, you know, the concept of taking a thing, but allowing somebody else, whether it's viewing through the video at the director level, or whoever's viewing it, to pull from it. I think that's a super important quality, and maybe something that is a good transition into talking about Ballard's High-Rise, mm-hmm. right? So quick recap or intro for the listener, if they haven't read it or read it a while ago. It's basically, it's kind of a weirdly dark anthropological novel in a way about this 30-year-old doctor. He's a divorcee. He moves into this luxury high-rise. And for reasons that aren't really explained, it sort of transitions between hedonistic parties, and then it basically crumbles into this more primitive civilization where things like violence and crime and assault become the norm, and then the individual sort of floors create their own clans, and they basically group themselves according to the lower, middle, and higher level of the high-rise. And so in some ways, it seems like a very specific story about how humans group themselves, and maybe it's commentary on class structure. But on the other hand, it also feels kind of vague. Like, why or how would you argue that this is possible? And so I guess mm-hmm. my question for you, since, you know, this is the thing that you said you've connected with, is, you know, what stands out to you? What's important to you about this book?
You know, I think the first line alone just pulled me in. It was, you know, it's one of those great setups to a story where mm-hmm. Ballard says, you know, as Lang like sunk his teeth into the dog, and you're just like, excuse me, what? What's happening here? You know, and it's just like this foreshadowing to some sort of another dimension. And I love stories that kind of dig deeper into the human condition. I feel like it's got a bit of a Lord of the Flies aspect to it, you know, in the mm-hmm. seeing how the extremes at which people will go. And I also can't help but see similarities, or at least connections to how the high rise was there. The high rise started to be the everything to these people. The outside world and their jobs outside of the building became secondary very much, and they became almost obsessed with this thing. And I see correlation between almost technology and mm-hmm. social media. It's a fascinating kind of link there that I think maybe the author was getting at. Maybe it was tying it in there, but obviously it's earlier than we had, you know, smartphones and everything. But maybe it was a comment on technology and how we're maybe putting too much emphasis on it, and we're stepping away from real human connection.
Yeah, I think that goes to kind of comment on sort of where this book lands in terms of Ballard's stuff, right? So his earlier things are kind of a little bit more traditional sci-fi, but this book people often group in terms with Crash and Concrete Island, which fits into where he went in terms of his sort of personal philosophy, which was that sci-fi explored outer space, but he was more interested in exploring the inner space. And specifically, right. I think you nail the thing of, you know, technology. And that's totally the read that I get from it this time, which my previous read, which is, I don't know, maybe 5 years ago. My dog agrees. That's why she's barking. It was focused, I think, a little bit on how ludicrous or not ludicrous this concept was. But now I totally see the read of, like, how much do we essentially acquiesce in terms of technology? How much do we allow ourselves to be taken over by these things? Mm-hmm. And how much is it really impacting our behavior as humans, right?
Right.
And I think that's such a scary, dark thing that didn't feel like fiction anymore. It felt like he was telling a prophecy.
Exactly. It's very much this choice that these people willingly made to enter this space, to live this certain way. And it was their undoing in a way. And it became an obsession, and it made them sick. And I don't know. I think the willingness of the people to do that knowingly to be the most dark aspect of it, and the biggest correlation to nowadays as well.
Yeah, there's one point in it that I had flagged that really stood out to me. And it's kind of a minor detail, but there's this weird sort of voyeurism aspect to it too, where one of the main characters, you could argue that there's sort of three main characters that are split up via classes. You have Wilder, you have Dr. Lang, and then you have Royal. Mm-hmm. And so Wilder is sort of on the bottom section of the high rise, and he's he works as a filmmaker. And then Dr. Lang is a doctor who teaches at a medical school. And then Royal at the top is the person who designed the entire building, right? Mm-hmm. And so Wilder, kind of the main arc or the main action of the novel is Wilder trying to literally climb the luxury tower, to climb to a different class,
becomes
right?
Becomes his obsession, yeah.
Yes, and he becomes totally obsessed with it. And he is willing to sacrifice everything for it. But he also is wielding his camera throughout the whole thing, right? Mm-hmm. And it becomes this weapon for him. But then there's this minor detail where they talk about people within the tower who are basically videotaping acts of violence and assault. And then they all get together to watch them again.
Right.
And they kind of get something from it. And if you just think about our current, you know, set of technology and media landscape, is that's what we all do, right? We're all looking for what's the next, like, actual captured violence entertainment just to give us our next hit, you know? And I was just amazed at that.
Yeah, and he and the others in the building, of course, become so desensitized to these horrendous things. And they become everyday and normalized in a way that is frightening. And it's just absolutely like nightmarish, and their hunger for it increases and increases and increases.
Yeah, it reminds me of a propaganda song. Mm-hmm. Ordinary people do fucked up things when fucked up things become ordinary. Ordinary people do fucked up things
when fucked up things become ordinary. Great band.
Like, boom. I was like, you, great band, great title. Everything about that is perfect. Mm-hmm. Super dead on. But yeah, you mentioned this like normalization aspect. I think one of the best aspects of this book is his prose. And I mean that in a way that it's not like you don't see sentences in here that totally blow your mind. It's a little bit more subtle than that. But what he does is he sort of normalizes all of these individual events to where in the beginning, like you said, that first sentence talks about a guy eating a dog, like it's a totally normal thing.
Yeah. And by the end of it, it is quite normal.
Yeah, exactly. But he works to sort of use that same sort of language and same sort of cool hand to describe, you know, tensions at a cocktail party versus, you know, there's lines about, oh, it was just a minor incident. One of the middle-aged, you know, inhabitants of the tower was knocked unconscious and thrown into the swimming pool.
Yeah.
And he kind of sneaks it by you. You're like, wait, what? I don't think that's a minor incident at all, man.
Exactly.
I think that's a big
problem.
That's
assault. Yeah. And attempted murder. Yeah. It's unbelievable. And the way he writes it, it's this very, I don't know if I realized it the first time reading it, but it's a slow burn. He really, really he's got patience and takes his time sort of telling the story, and I think that allows for things to very gradually escalate, and you almost don't notice it, like you were saying. You're just, by the end of it, you're like, wow, look where we are. And I think that's very much the case in real life, is that over time you don't notice these shifts, but then if you look at A to B, we've gone a very far away, mm-hmm. in a very long way. And it can be shocking.
Yeah, and I wanted to read a quote, and this is towards the end of the book, kind of at that end point. And it goes, "He enjoyed watching Steele at work, obsessed with these expressions of mindless violence. Each one brought them a step closer to the ultimate goal of the high rise, a realm where their most deviant impulses were free at last to exercise themselves in any way they wished. At this point, physical violence would cease at last." Which is, to me, one of the darkest, like, pieces of commentary in the book, which is that the only way for these tensions and these conflicts and this literal violence to cease is to basically normalize it to where it is the only thing, thus that it doesn't really exist because it doesn't stand out from what normalcy is.
Yeah, it becomes the new status quo. That's what they were all almost, they were all kind of looking at it as like, soon everything will be back to normal. And because mm-hmm. that will be, they will have just become accustomed to this, like this violence and eating dogs and whatnot.
Yeah, and that was the thing that really stuck with me on the read through this time around, because you know, I think we're all in the midst of the year 2020. It's difficult in, you know, a thousand different directions. But somehow there's this thing in the human spirit that manages to get through it, right? I mean, so I'm in West Coast of the US, the wildfires plus the pandemic mm-hmm. plus the political situation, like all of that is a lot, right? But there's something about how humans can figure out how to deal with that. And I think the dark underside of it is that, yeah, it is because we normalize things. And once you normalize a thing, what's the next thing that you're going to normalize? And it's just that slippery slope of basically how good humans are at that and how comfortable we can become once, you know, a new set of standards is laid out for us, that I think he just nailed, right?
Yeah. And it's the fascinating part of this book. And also, it's the thing, it's the most frightening as well, because it hits home.
Yeah, exactly. And I also loved, like, he had these descriptions of the individual sort of groups and clans and classes. And, you know, there's always this concept of agency and how much do you really have control over an individual. And basically, he would make these arguments for each of the individual groups that, you know, you don't really control that whatsoever. I mean, whatever your independent thought is, it's shaped by a lot of other things. Mm-hmm. And so another quote to read, and this is from the perspective of Royal, talking about sort of the, call them the upper middle class inhabitants of the tower. He says, "Above all, he looked down on them for their good taste. The building was a monument to good taste, to the well-designed kitchen, to sophisticated utensils and fabrics, to elegant and never ostentatious furnishings. In short, to that whole aesthetic sensibility which these well-educated professional people had inherited from all the schools of industrial design, all the award-winning schemes of interior decoration institutionalized by the last quarter of the 20th century." And he's basically, you know, also calling out how much we just sort of follow whatever the trends are. It's really, it's that groupthink and how as much as maybe we try to tell ourselves that we're independent beings, that we're really just at the mercy of whatever that momentum is.
Yeah.
Right.
Trends and what the neighbor is doing. It's all very much, you know, very real. I live in downtown Toronto and I don't know. I felt there's so many examples in this book. I mean, of just correlations I see. I was like, yeah, we all do this. We like, absolutely. You know, it hasn't gone to an extreme, of course, like this. It's pushed to a horrific like limit. But yeah, you know, we're in a lot of ways not in control. I've always thought that. I think it's a bit of an illusion if we think that we're the ones calling the shots.
Mm-hmm. So it's funny, we started out by talking about how missing, you know, the cathartic aspect of live music, and you know, specifically if you're into, you know, quote unquote more coarse or aggressive music, oftentimes that is a total lifeline, right? Mm-hmm. Because it gives you that outlet. And I think he calls this real well too. And you know, I'm just going to keep reading quotes because I've realized I totally love this book. And so he writes, "The model here seems to be that our uninnocent post-Freudian selves, outraged by all that overindulgent toilet training, dedicated breastfeeding, and parental affection, obviously a more dangerous mix than anything our Victorian forebears had to cope with. Our neighbors had happy childhoods to a man and still feel angry. Perhaps they resent never having had a chance to become perverse." And I think that's another scary thing, which is that, you know, if we don't have our outlets, we have to create them somehow.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a thing that's been burning in my head too, where, you know, if you believe current, you know, projections and stuff from the scientific community about how long we're going to be in this pandemic scenario, we're not real close to it being over, mm-hmm. right?
No, it's true.
Which is very saddening and not all that fun to think about.
No, I certainly see the activities that all of the people that lived in the high rise that they were taking part in. There was, like, you know, hedonistic, there was lots of partying, but like the, you know, playing, what was it, flying lesson or something like that? Just, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Things like this, I equate them to people being vicious to each other online. I kind of just see them as like taking out your bad day on someone else who you don't know and who you've never met, and who, like, just things like that, where some kind of perceived reason to dislike someone else, you know, you don't have to look too hard to find it if that's what you want, and that's what you require to sort of blow off some steam, and yeah, and it's a reason why I try to, you know, stay the hell away from most social media. It's terrifying to me.
Yeah, I've always wondered, like, who has, like, what's the energy of that person who's typing out that super angry YouTube comment? But you're right, maybe they need it.
I think some of the people who do it, they absolutely love it. Like, you can tell, like, it's obviously an outlet coming from a place of frustration, but also you know, there's got to be an instantaneous gratification there that's happening, something that's making them carry on that way and do it. But yeah, I don't know. That's just a guess.
Yeah. Yeah. You mentioned the let's play flying, which is a thing that happens towards the end of the book, where the game flying, the characters joke about it, is that you really only need to play it once because it's just throwing a person off of the top of this building.
Right.
Right. But there's an interesting layer there in that kind of as the book progresses and as Wilder, you know, seeks to climb the whole tower, initially unsuccessfully, but he keeps getting more and more creative. But there's sort of new structures that emerge in terms of the social groups. And towards the end of the book, as he sort of lands at the top of the tower and he's exhausted and I guess spoiler alerts, but he has almost killed Royal, and he ends up, there's this new power structure at the top, which actually I want to ask your opinion in terms of how you interpreted it, but I believe it's a group of cannibal women, right?
Right. And children. Yeah.
And children. Right.
Yeah. I don't know what I took from that. I was like, okay. At that point, nothing was shocking. But yeah, I think you're right.
Yeah. As an author, he had successfully sort of numbed you to where, when that scene happened, where this group of women start to close in around Wilder, and I think they're referred to as his new mothers.
That's right.
And they all have knives, right? As a reader, you're like, oh, that seems practical, I guess. yeah, it's not that different. But then you take a step back and you're like, wait, what? And I think that is a testament to, again, some of this, like, prophetic nature of Ballard, which is, you know, he was really looking at how we interact with new technology. And you saw it in Crash, right, when he was talking about, you know, automobiles and linking them to sexual fetishes. Mm-hmm. You saw that also in Concrete Island, where it's basically a guy that gets sort of trapped in this no man's land between freeways, and he can't get out, and he just sort of acquiesces and sort of slides back into a new existence. And I think the author was always playing around with that, which is, you know, what are these structures that we're putting in place now, and how are they actually impacting how our social orders react to them, but then also may rearrange themselves? And is the way that they've rearranged themselves, is it necessarily better? Is it worse? And I think we're still grappling with that, like, in today's society, as it's becoming more and more obvious that the technology that we're submitting ourselves is really starting to impact our emotions to a degree that I don't think we were used to.
There's no way for anyone to know, right, how it would affect us. And And I truly believe, like, the intent of the people who, you know, made these technologies and sort of saw them as being tools, they didn't have any ill intention. Like, just like the, like, Royal, the creating the high-rise, it was intended to be this wonderful thing, I think, for everyone. And everyone saw it that way. And it, you know, morphed, and the impact it had on everyone was obviously incredibly negative. And that's the danger, I think, of inventions and technology, that you just don't know where, which way they're going to go.
Yeah, and I think about that, you know, the loop of how we act on the internet is not really how we act in real life. But the scarier part is what happens when we start acting in real life like how we act on the internet. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the end point that he was kind of getting at. This is what happens when you've acquiesced to this force, right? And you've allowed it to become really the authentic full structure of our human existence.
Right.
And like, holy shit. Like honestly, I do think we're in the middle of that, right? And you see more people without their outlets, and it's just exacerbated by the current situation with the pandemic and isolation and stuff like that. And I just keep looking at this as some sort of forward-looking text that 40 years later, he just kind of foretold it.
Me too. I really do. I mean, some writers have just been able to do that. I think of, like, I don't know, Orwell or, you know, or Bradbury or something like that. They're just being able to, like, tap into, like, what's going to happen. And I think for a lot of people now, it's not too far-fetched to say, like, their online life is what matters to them most. It is more important to, mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that's good or bad. I'm just saying I think that may be the case for a lot of people, where it's like their real life, or what they enjoy most and what they see as being important to them, is their online relationships and the things they do online. Where, and you know, the outside world, like being outside of the high rise, they always rushed to get back to the high rise. They hated it out there. They go, oh, can't wait to get back to the high rise, even though it was like this absolute zoo, right? It was falling mm-hmm. apart. The water wasn't running. No one had food, you know, and people were, you know, violent to each other. And yeah, it's fascinating.
Yeah, I was thinking about that specific topic of most days. Towards the end, it kind of slowed down, but most days through the arc of this novel, you know, all of the characters would get up, they would shower and clean themselves up and shave, and they would head off to their totally regular lives. And then they would come back, and there was almost these agreements within the high rise of, there's kind of an armistice for, you know, the elevators that they had to run during these certain hours before they allowed them to be taken over and sort of regulated by, like, kind of the tribal tactics, right? Mm-hmm. And I sort of asked myself, you know, that the internet example, I think, is kind of the main illusion here, which is just that, to what extent are we continually almost hiding and apologizing for what our behavior is in this online world, right? Where it's very obvious, if you look at it specifically, that this is not how it should be. But suddenly we leave, we go to work, we do our stuff in the real world, and we pretend that that's not how we're behaving, quote unquote, in there. But then we're actually addicted to it. We want to just put ourselves back into it, mm-hmm. right?
Absolutely, yeah.
And that was a topic that, again, like, I think 5 years ago is when I had first read this, it felt to me a little almost silly. And I was just like, yeah, well, somebody would call the police, right? Wouldn't they?
Right. No one wants to, they want to make sure that no one is privy to the fact, like, of all the things that are happening inside their world. Although everything that's happening in their world is illegal and awful. Yeah, but they still want it to be a secret, right?
Yeah, I think we're all sort of collectively guilty and complicit in those things, right? And that's really what he was getting at with human nature, which is, once you start to have, like, groups participating in these things, it becomes really difficult to objectively say, hey, this really isn't how it should be, because at some level, as an individual, you've also been doing part of it, right? Mm-hmm. I can probably openly say that I have not once ever typed an angry comment on a YouTube comment list. I'm hoping to hold that for the rest of my life. But I think the way that we've all been impacted and emotionally engaged with the internet is kind of suspect, right? And I think, like, why don't we call out this stuff of, hey, there's no reason that it should be operating like this? And I think it's because we're all sucked in, but we also kind of like it. And maybe if you go a step further, prefer it.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's exactly what I get from the book. That's what I get when I look around, you know, right now in this day and age. Yeah, I don't think I'm myself included. I mean, I think I'm addicted to social media, and I openly dislike it, you know, and I'm still addicted mm-hmm. to it. You know, I'm more of like a lurker, I guess, you know, just like checking in on when there was shows, I'd use it to see what's happening or just check on new music out there. Like, but I wouldn't go a day without it, you know, not unless mm-hmm. I was out in the wilderness or something. So yeah, I can't separate myself from anyone else when it comes to that.
Yeah. So I guess, I mean, this book has rattled me in a lot of good ways, in a lot of ways that I think are maybe not so good, but necessary. And yes, I just want to say I really appreciate the time talking through this and saying, like, you know, what you've pulled from it, how you've linked this to things that you've made and music and all that. And yeah, it's been a little trying to get through this because we're in this isolated period, and yeah. Reading a book about human behavior in extreme isolation is like a little on the nose.
Yeah, I apologize about that. Yeah, it is a bit heavy. It's funny, our album came out today and it's intense music, obviously, and I read a comment of someone being like, listen guys, I love you, but I can't handle this right now. It's just like, and you know, I had to laugh, but it's like I yeah, it's true, this book is very on the nose for where we're at right now. And I don't know, I'm usually just sort of drawn to that type of story and that kind of storytelling.
Yeah, well, I will say that there are a lot of us out there who much like the inhabitants of the high-rise, need some of this to, quote-unquote, get their fix.
Yeah.
So whether it's reading this extremely fucking on-the-nose book or listening to some music that makes me just so intensely miss being at a sweaty live show, I just appreciate the time. I appreciate that you're putting that stuff out there, because I do think it's super meaningful. And so I thank you for that.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Thanks for listening. You can find out more about METZ at METZZTEM.com. It's a mirror image of the band name. You get it. Their fourth record, Atlas Vending, is available now via Sub Pop Records. You can find out more about Books of Some Substance at booksofsomesubstance.com and on Instagram and Twitter with the handle BooksOSubstance. And even though we just spent 45 minutes bemoaning what the internet is doing to our brains, I'm still going to have the audacity to say that liking things, subscribing to things, and posting angry comments on our YouTube, all these things are helpful. So thanks for playing the game with us. Until next time, happy reading.
It's one of those books, like, that first line and everything about it has always, it's never left me, you know? It's just stayed with me for some mm-hmm. reason. Have you seen the movie?
I have not seen the movie.
Yeah.
And my friend Eric, not that this would be included in the podcast, but he was like, don't watch it, it's not very good. So I blame him.
Yeah, I like the director. He did a crazy, if I've got it right, he did a crazy movie called A Field in England, which is bonkers psychedelia. But yeah, I have to agree, the movie did not live up to the book.
Okay, cool. Yeah. I'll let him know that he properly gave me the correct guidance.
Yeah, I agree with him.